Guys, what's up? Welcome back to MJ Fangirl TV. I'm here with a special guest, an amazing friend of mine, Gadget Trish.
I was like, what's your name?
I know. I was like, she has two channels, Gadget Trish and her new Jackson family channel you guys have to follow. It's called I Love the Jackson Family.
Yes, we just did a collaboration for the Janet Jackson watch party. MJ Fangirls in part one, so please check that out. It was really fun. So we always said we were going to do a collaboration when vegan KFC came out, but she's in Cali and I'm in New York, so this is our compromise. We are doing it online.
Yes. So
I got me a 6-piece nuggets with fries. Got some.
I know. I got me some tenders, and. In the spirit of the collaboration we just did and the celebration of the Janet Jackson documentary, we figured we would collaborate by watching the making of Scream!
Fitting, because in the documentary, they had some behind-the-behind scenes of them making Scream the song. So I think this will be my first time seeing the making of this all together.
Yeah, I'm excited. I don't think I've seen, like, this long version. I've only seen, like, 10 second clips, 2-minute clips. So this is like a longer 15-minute version. So,
oh, this is so cool. I'm so in the Janet Jackson spirit. Shout out to Janet.
I know.
And Michael.
So,
of course, from the history era too, right?
Yes, exactly.
I'm so proud of you. I'm feeling that.
Yeah, I was like, I gotta match the era. You know, I try.
That's
So, okay, you guys, so without further ado, stay tuned. You don't want to miss this epic collaboration reaction video. You are now watching MJ Fangirl TV. Girl, you got to. Hold on. Kitty.
She's funny. So the KFC's there, and she's like sniffing like, you want more food? You want a french fry?
All right, you guys, let's get into this video and enjoy our chicken.
Right here on the Universal lot, Michael Jackson made the video for Scream. Hi, I'm Allison Stewart from MTV News, and we will have that video for you very shortly. Now, of course, when Michael Jackson makes a video, it is always an event. But this time, he is literally making history. Scream is a duet with his sister Janet, and it marks the first time that Michael's ever recorded with his superstar sibling. And of course, Janet's going to be in the video as well. And see that soundstage behind me? It is one of 5 housing 10 sets used in the $7 million project.
I wonder if this was in LA.
Right.
Really,
in terms of the visuals that they're applying to Scream, what do you think about the combination? Does it work for you?
Yeah, I think the combination is really cool because it kind of is taking place in a spaceship or kind of in a vacuum. I think the spaceship is kind of a metaphor of the vacuum that their lives sort of are. Sometimes they're looked upon as not human. Of course, they are human, but...
Okay, maybe that's kind of a surrealistic way
to say that, you know, here we are out in space and we're connecting with each other as brother and sister.
Yeah. We wrote the song together. It was fun. The first time we've ever worked together, sang together, aside from PYT, but that's just a little background thing he asked me to do.
So the throwback, PYT.
That was years ago.
Little known fact, right?
Yes.
It's been 13 years since Michael Jackson's kid sister added some backing vocals to his album, Thriller. Janet Jackson's now a superstar in her own right. And clearly, she and her brother have a mutual respect that transcends the personal to professional levels, as was evident from a very public show of affection at the 1993 Grammy Awards.
I'm pleased to be here tonight to honor the man I love and admire as an artist and a person, my brother, Michael Jackson.
This is like my favorite. I love
this. I just wanted to tell you how proud I am of you and how much you've inspired me and how proud I am to be your sister and how much I love you. I do.
Aww. And we're proud to be your fans. Woohoo!
I know, right? Of both of them.
Me and Janet really are two different people.
It was definitely, I did feel that little sister thing. It'll always be that way because that's what I am. And he's my big brother.
Scream isn't simply a collaboration between two artists. It's the melding of two creative camps. Both Michael and Janet Jackson have brought his and her inner circle to the project to create the Scream team.
Karen Faye.
You are instrumental in Janet's success as an artist. Did she bring you aboard this project? Say, hey, Jimmy, come work with me and my brother?
Yes, she did. She, you know, tied us up, beat us over our head and said, you will do this duet. You will do this duet.
Michael and Janet Jackson are both well known for their innovative dance steps. But Janet now lends a certain street credibility to Michael's pedestal popularity. To communicate the combination of these two styles, four choreographers were employed for the staging of Scream. You hear co-directing and co-producing, but you don't hear co-choreographers very often.
Yeah, but I mean, when you get Michael Jackson and Janet Jackson, you got to have, you know, best of both worlds. So it wouldn't be fair to exclude one entity because, you know, we've both had significant roles in, you know, their visual, the visual appeal.
That's awesome.
We are working with Janet and Travis and Lavelle are working mostly with Michael, but then at one point when they are working together, it's kind of...
Tina was in that documentary too, right?
All four of us come together.
Yeah, she was.
And collaborate and use as many, you know, as many ideas and energies that we can.
But there are differences, you know, movement-wise. Janet, she thrashes. I mean, that girl will, you know, she'll go for it, you know. And Michael will do the same thing, but it's just where his presence is just so much different than hers, you know. She's a hard hitter. Michael goes between, you know, soft, supple movement to crash and burn.
While Michael's look hasn't changed dramatically for the video, Janet's adopted quite a different video persona.
She's been looking very sort of soft and golden and very sexy and everything. And he wanted something that looked very raw. And as we started talking about it and started talking about the futuristic sort of aspect of it, the idea of her looking sort of like Edward Scissorhands meets, you know, futuristic sort of Japanese superhero.
Minimalism were the buzzwords used to describe Scream. To turn the futuristic fantasy into a reality, Jackson turned to the video director of the moment, Mark Romanek. He's the eye behind breakthrough clips for Madonna, Nine Inch Nails, Lenny Kravitz, En Vogue, and R.E.M.
Mark has got a great track record, and he's very creative, very innovative, so it only seemed right that, you know, he would be working on this with Michael and Janet.
Michael, take a step just in front of the ramp.
I've always wanted to work with Mark. I think he's an absolute genius in it. I was so freaked out and excited that I was gonna be able to work with him on this video. The Rain video, Constant Craving, the En Vogue, Free Your Mind video. I mean, they were all so revolutionary.
Oh, wow.
And still, when you look at them today, they look like, even 10 years from now, they would look revolutionary. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're just so beautifully done. The lighting is perfect. The cuts are all perfect. You could push the pause button on any of Mark's videos and they're like these beautiful photographs.
This is the Zen Garden set, one of the many you will see in the video Scream, the first release from Michael Jackson's album, History, Past, Present, and Future, Book One. We'll get into the making of that album next, and of course show you Scream in its entirety when we return.
This is so cool. I love hearing the input of the choreographers and the makeup artists, you know?
Mm-hmm.
You don't get that often with Michael.
No.
Michael Jackson Weekend.
History, Past, Present, and Future, Book One. That mouthful is the title of Michael Jackson's long-awaited and long-delayed album of 15 greatest hits, which have been digitally remastered, and 15 new tracks. Now, this is a very important album for Michael Jackson. Not only is it his first release of new material since 1991's Dangerous, it's his first musical statement following the tumultuous events and the intense scrutiny of the past few years. Jackson has led a public life. Recently, however, the private aspects of his life have overshadowed his musical output. From his highly publicized string of appearances in early 1993 to the specter of child molestation charges that were filed that fall and subsequently dropped, then settled out of court with Jackson cleared.
I am totally innocent of any wrongdoing.
There was his admission of addiction to painkillers and a surprise marriage to Elvis Presley's daughter, Lisa Marie.
And just think, nobody thought this would last.
The combination of events left many wondering how his experience would manifest itself in his music.
If you're an artist and you put your feelings on your record and in your music, it gives it a whole different energy than it would have if you're just singing, you know, well, la da da, whatever. He sang what was on his mind, and it's a very aggressive, very personal album. And it's, you know, to me, it's his finest album just because of that fact.
Yeah. A lot of people would say that.
On battle, so personal. Fact, pissed off Michael going on the offensive, lambasting his critics.
They wanted the song to be very aggressive. It was interesting. Somebody asked me, you know, what's the song like? And I said, well, it ain't a ballad, you know? It's not a ballad.
It's not a ballad.
And very aggressive. And lyrically, it's very aggressive, too. And it had to be up-tempo, obviously, so they can move and dance and do their thing to it. So just trying to match the song to kind of what they were feeling, you know, lyrically was what we tried to do.
It was very interesting to see him at work, because I hadn't seen him in a really long time. I think the last time I saw him at work was the Thriller album.
Wow.
Just being there in the studio with him, just watching, observing. So it was fun. It was a lot of fun. We had a great time. We reminisced and laughed a lot. And just had a really good time.
Janet also is showing a lot of support for a brother, you know, because this is a big album for him. It's coming back after a long period of time, a lot of turmoil in his life. And it's an important album for him, and I think that's the other thing, too, is that she's just happy to be there and support him.
Also joining Michael Jackson for this project are Slash, the Notorious B.I.G., Shaquille O'Neal, producer Dallas Austin, R. Kelly, and Boyz II Men.
It was exciting. I mean, you know, being in the studio with Michael Jackson. For one, Michael wasn't even supposed to be in the studio. He had a session at another studio, and he actually moved his session over to our studio just so he could be involved in the session.
You don't think you're going to ever get a chance to talk to him because, you know, you people think that he's so untouchable, and that's the way we felt until we actually talked to him and met him.
Wow. They don't necessarily consider him as being a very, like, intelligent entrepreneur, you know what I'm saying? They just see him as this guy that has pale skin and, you know, he's buying bones and stuff like that, you know what I'm saying? Things like, they go for the real, the sensationalism of the whole thing. So they don't really consider him as even being a real human. One thing I can tell you is you got to be free.
The new album contains 14 new tracks, along with a cover of The Beatles' Come Together, originally recorded for the Moonwalker film. Not to be overlooked is the inclusion of 15 of Michael Jackson's greatest hits, digitally remastered.
CD technology back when off the wall and Thriller and some of those records came out was still a very new technology. And, you know, any technology gets better and better and better. And it's just a totally different, it's like hearing the songs for the first time. Actually hear things in the song that you've never heard before. They were always there, but because the technology was new, people didn't know how to actually put it on CD and do it the right way. So it's a pretty amazing process.
The two CD set includes a 52-page booklet complete with sketches, photos of Michael and friends, testimonials from those friends, and a listing of Jackson's various achievements. Before there was even a video shot for the song Scream, there was a trailer shot for the album, a multi-million dollar trailer of epic proportions, simply to announce the arrival of the new release.
I love this teaser. I love everything about it. I wish we had like a long version of it. It's so good.
It still looks new, like it just came out.
Right? Michael would go ahead and describe it. It looks like timeless art.
We worked in Budapest, Hungary. We had thousands of soldiers from different regions in the world. And we staged and choreographed along with Michael, the soldiers, as well as, you know, his bits and
flag men, everything. We had flag men, rifles, and you name it, we choreographed it.
What was the message you were trying to put forth?
Power, and he's back.
Power and unity.
Power, and he's back with a vengeance.
Back with a vengeance indeed. Michael Jackson, along with his label Epic Records, is launching a full-scale marketing assault. And so far, it's working. The first single, Scream, had the highest debut ever in the history of the Billboard singles charts, entering at number 5. It also includes Childhood from the movie Free Willy 2. You've seen
my child. I've never seen this movie.
And up next,
me either. I've never seen
the futuristic video that is Scream. It's
comment down below if you guys have
and
never
Janet
seen Free Willy like us.
Right?
Is it worth watching for those of you that have seen it?
This was a good pick, MJFANGIRL, because we just saw the documentary last week.
Right. It's
so I feel like it's tied in.
Yeah, the timing is really good. That was fun. Okay, you guys, that was so much fun. Really timely, as you were saying, Trish, because we just finished watching the Janet documentary. Yeah, like, what are your thoughts? What was your favorite part?
My favorite part was just getting more insight. I found it interesting, though, they didn't interview Michael.
That's true.
It was only, right? It's only Janet, Terry Lewis, the other choreographer, forget his name.
Tina Landon.
Yeah, but I was like, no, Michael?
Yeah, that was weird. I would have loved to hear from Michael about recording this. I thought it was really interesting that we had the two different sets of choreographers, and they were explaining, like, Lavelle Smith Jr. and Travis Payne were explaining the differences between Michael's movements and stuff, and why it was important to have two choreographers. But I'm thinking back to the Janet documentary when she was saying that they kept them separate, and I just wonder, like, I don't know, did they keep them more separate than she would have liked? I mean, because they kind of explained why everything was separate, because they still wanted to have each person's individuality as an artist like represented. So I don't know, maybe Janet felt some type of way because it was being done like amongst the staff and not really like between them as brother and sister.
Yeah, I watched the documentary about 4 times now, and every time I watch it, there is a longing to reconnect with her brother Michael the way it was back in Gary/early 80s. And then you see how they're separate, and then you see her documentary, and you're like, this has a whole different meaning now, you know?
Yeah.
This has a whole different meaning. This is a sister who wanted to reconnect with her brother and, of course, support him through everything that he was going through. This was the first really, really bad publicity on Michael ever.
Right. Yeah, and it's crazy because I think as an MJ fan, I've always looked at it like, I don't know. I've always looked at Michael like, wow, he was like this like otherworldly artist and stuff, which he was, but I wasn't thinking of, and I kind of thought of it as like him doing a favor to Janet. I never thought of the context of the time of like him having gone through what he went through and Janet being kind of at the top of her game. So it was really in support of him, which like you said, is just like, it's like, wow, you know, if I think back to it, it's amazing that, you know, with context and with the behind the scenes of like the actual things that were happening during that time, we understand more what the significance was.
It was interesting how they spoke about the allegations for the behind the scenes. I was like, wait, what? But I mean, of course I was around for the 90s. I was a teenager then, but you still don't remember things the same. You know, your life is around your friends and school and it's different. So, you know, and honestly, I don't remember seeing this. Knowing me, I didn't have cable, to be honest. So that's why I probably didn't see it.
Right,
but
right.
But it was just like, wow, you know, I don't even remember how I felt back then about Michael. I remember I was very supportive, though. Like, I never believed the allegations ever.
Right.
I just, to see it now, many years later, it just has a whole different, I'm kind of glad I've seen it now. It's like a whole different thing now.
Yeah, me too. And I'm glad we're watching this after, like you said, Janet's documentary and having context and, you know, seeing, was that Jimmy Jam or Terry Lewis?
I believe that was Terry Lewis.
Okay. So, yeah, seeing him talk and, yeah, it was just really, really a good full circle way to kind of wrap up Janet Jackson week or the 2 weeks or Janet Jackson month.
Well, technically it's going to be a Janet Jackson month. Now, next week, Super Bowl Sunday, is Janet Jackson Appreciation Day.
Right.
And
yes.
That is in her fans pretty much saying it wasn't right to cancel her for Nipplegate.
Right.
So we're not done. I feel like it's going to be a Janet Jackson month by the time this is over. Every Super Bowl Sunday, it's Janet Jackson Appreciation Day. So we are celebrating. I might even do like a little dinner like how I did for her documentary. I might go to Red Bamboo again. Maybe yeah. Go to her favorite. I think her favorite is Chicken Parmesan.
Yes, that's like her favorite. Is it her favorite vegan place in New York?
Yeah.
Red Bamboo.
Good. It's interesting. Like she got that back in 2010. I became vegan 5 years ago. I don't think I have a favorite vegan restaurant yet, to be honest. I like my food better.
Well, Trish, you're a good cook. You like experiment with so many things, so I can see that. I probably would like your food better than the restaurants too.
Shout out to KFC. They yeah. Now have a vegan option, and of course there's a connection between KFC and Michael Jackson. It's noted as one of his favorite places to eat. I got the 6-piece nugget, french fries, hot sauce, because none of the sauces are vegan. There's honey in them. Yeah. I think that's my biggest gripe. I remember we went to Thriller Night and the day before. I was like, I'm tired of going to places and only something's not always vegan. So it's like, oh, just make it all vegan.
Right.
Can we get vegan sauces?
Well, I'm super glad we got to do this. I loved like collaborating with you today with our KFC and our Michael versus Janet Scream, making of Scream rather, video choice. And let people know where they can find you online.
You can find me on IG, Instagram, Tumblr, Facebook, and of course YouTube under I Love the Jackson Family. And I believe my Twitter is Love for the Jacksons because the name was too long, so they wouldn't let me have I Love the Jackson Family. But those are where you can find me for now.
Okay, you guys, so that's where you can find her. You guys know you can find me here on MJ Fangirl TV. All right, you guys, thank you guys so much for watching, and we'll see you guys next time. Bye.